Thanksgiving yet, but I did not have a chance to greet you. Happy Thanksgiving this week. So, happy Thanksgiving. Happy eating. Are we ready to eat today? I'm not talking about the turkey. I'm talking about the Word of God. I mean, how many are ready to be fed with the Word of God today? How many are ready to receive the Word of God? So, before we jump into our message this morning, let's ask the Lord to bless us and to take control of this service this morning. Let's pray. Father God, we are so grateful, Lord, that we are gathered here together again in your name. We are gathered as one body, ready to worship you, ready to receive from you. And I pray, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit will just take control of this service now, take control of me. And as I speak your word, I will speak the truth. Whatever comes out of my mouth will come directly from you. Because whatever words that comes out of my mouth, if it's my own, doesn't mean anything. But your word means everything. So I pray that you take control of this service now. In Jesus' name. Amen. It's good to be back behind the pulpit. Amen. How many Sundays did I have to preach? 3 Sundays in a row, I think. And sometimes it feels good to be taking a break. But I'm beginning to like or love the mission field now. So, how many would like to go with me to a mission field? This time it's Afghanistan. Or change. It changed. You had to change. You think I was talking about Davao or Bukidnon, which is a beautiful place. Well, it's a place where God really worked. But like I said, I'm beginning to love the mission field, and when you see the happy faces of little children when they receive their backpack with school supplies and shoes. And there are some of them are very tiny that the backpack is covering them. The backpack is dragging in their back. But they're so happy. When they were given the, was that spaghetti? Spaghetti. Spaghetti and chicken. Thank you, Jed, for that generosity. They were so happy, and there was also some panic moment because the caterer made some lumpia for the staff. And without knowing it, they gave it away to the kids. So there was a panic moment, like, where's the lumpia? And they found it with the boys. I don't know if they have already eaten some of it. But it's a joy to see them. And it's a spirit uplifting when my message today is about generosity. So I'm going to be kind of telling you what happened to our mission trip. So it was a spirit uplifting to see people whose main diet is banana and camote. In Bukidnon, it's good to see their faces lit up when they receive a bag of rice. And it makes you want to do it again. And also when I saw the people line up to be baptized, I don't know how many of them are here. 30? There were 30 people that were baptized. And it didn't matter whether the water's cold or I was shaking, but it's a spirit uplifting experience. And all I could think of was the words of Jesus to go into all the world and preach the gospel, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So it was a joy to be part of that water baptism. And it's a good experience when you see people that have not seen the ocean yet. Most of them, it was their first time to see the beach. And they just have to taste the water. One boy, after I baptized him, he complains, "Napait." So the water was bitter. I do not know if the salt was bitter because the water wasn't so clean. So it could be true that it tastes bitter. And also an older gentleman that I baptized. See, I asked him before I baptized him, I asked him if they received Jesus as their personal Savior. So I asked this older gentleman, did you receive Jesus as your Savior? I said, "Yes, Father." So all those experiences, in spite of, you know, it was a short trip, it was just a go, 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 go thing. And we have no enough rest, but then when you see the faces, the happy faces of people, whether they receive something or they're being baptized, it's very spirit uplifting. So I said, beginning to love the mission field. So I called them a couple days ago. Actually, I talked to my Pastor Helen last night. And just to follow up, whether we made an impact on our mission trip, like giving away school supplies and shoes and food and what have you. So, just to find out whether, what was the result. So, in Eden Church is the main church that we have there. We have three churches, two churches in Davao and one church in Bukidnon. Bukidnon is a different province. So in Eden Church, as a direct result of the giving away of school supplies, a whole family came and came to church and worshiped with them. In Bukidnon Church, on Sunday after we left, they told me that the church was packed. So That's what happens when we are generous. That's what generosity can do. And also, not as a direct result of the giving away of food supplies and school supplies, in Eden, a whole family showed up. It's different from another family that showed up because of the they received the school supplies. Another family showed up as a result of manicure and pedicure. Our ladies have a little treat themselves to the pedicure, manicure, and massage. There were two sisters that were doing it. They were doing the massage and also doing the manicure and pedicure. But they were so touched because our ladies were generous of their tip. They were generous of their tip. And not only that, they heard the gospel or somebody shared to them during the duty time. And I was told that 8 members of the family came to church, gave their lives to the Lord. So that's because we are generous. We don't just go there and preach the gospel and without, we did a again, we did a feeding, we did gifts of food and school supplies, and of course the generous tip led people giving themselves to the Lord. And Jesus himself did the same thing. Jesus, when he preached, and when people were hungry, he fed them. Remember the 5,000, the feeding of the 5,000? When Jesus was preaching, and then evening came, it was dark, and there was no food around to eat. And the immediate reaction of the disciples was, "Lord, send them away. Let them get their own food. There's no food here." And Jesus responded that you don't have to do that. You have to send them away. Give them something to eat. So they had 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes. So we're not just preaching the gospel, but we're also giving them something. James put it this way in James chapter 2, verse 15. I'm reading from the NLT version. "Suppose you see a brother or sister who has no food or clothing, and you say goodbye and have a good day, stay warm and eat well. But you don't give that person any food or clothing, what good does that do?" So sometimes we, as a church, we preach the gospel and we don't back it up with action. Where sometimes we're just out there and telling people to give their lives to the Lord, but then we leave them hungry and empty. But thank God for Generosity is powerful. It can change life. The title of my message today is Generosity in Action. Generosity is one of the virtues that the Bible encourages us to have and to grow deeper into maturity. All over the Bible, you will find generosity is encouraged. There are just a few of them. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 10 says, God is not unjust. He will not forget your work and the love you have shown him as you have helped his people. Continue to help them. There is that one verse that encourages generosity. Another one in Proverbs, found in Proverbs chapter 19, verse 17. Whoever is kind to the poor lends to the Lord, and he will reward them for what they have done. So, again, it says here that whoever is kind to the poor lends to the Lord. In other words, you are kind to the poor, you are reaching out in generosity to people. You're doing it also to the Lord, and the Lord will reward us for generosity. There's another one. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 16 says, and do not forget to do good, to share with others. For with such sacrifices, God is pleased. So, for me, generosity is the highest form of thanksgiving. Thanksgiving is more than just saying thank you, a few words of thank you, and then eat a lot of turkey. That's basically how we celebrate Thanksgiving. So when I preached there first Sunday, I shared to them, because that was their Thanksgiving, I shared to them how we celebrate Thanksgiving here in America. I said, in America, we celebrate Thanksgiving maybe a little differently. And the most obvious difference between Thanksgiving there and Thanksgiving here is, I said, the lipson. We have the turkey. But I said, Thanksgiving in America is like a tradition. Family gets together, and correct me if I'm wrong, maybe you're doing it better in your house. We get together with all the food that we can bring, and then we ask somebody to pray for the food. And the person that prays for the food prays the longest, probably three minutes. And then we eat the whole night. Am I correct? We eat the whole night. And then from there, if you have another family, if you have a big family, you jump from one place, from one house to another, and eat again. Let me ask you, where is the Thanksgiving there? Where is the thanksgiving? That's why I said, generosity is the highest form of thanksgiving. Because thanksgiving, there's two words, thanks and giving. That's why I proposed that I change the holiday name to thanks, from thanksgiving to thanks by giving. Because I'm sorry, that's how we celebrate here. We should not just celebrate and just gather together as a family and eat the whole night. It should be thanks to God by giving generously. Let me give you three deep truths about generosity. These are my 3 points. Number one, generosity comes from the heart. Second, generosity is powerful. Third, generosity keeps the blessings flowing. So generosity comes from the heart. I often hear people say, and I hear this all the time, we say, let the rich give because they have a lot of money. You hear that most of the time? Let them, they have a lot of money, so you know, let them give. But generosity does not come from having a lot of money or lack of it. Just because you have a lot of money, that means that doesn't mean you're generous. Just because you have lack, you do not have a lot of money, doesn't mean that you should be stingy. Because generosity comes and starts from the heart. The people with lots of money could be as stingy as anyone else. Generosity has nothing to do with having a lot or lack of money. Generosity doesn't start with money. It starts with the right heart. It's never a money issue. It is a heart issue. Okay? So the next time you think of being giving or not giving, always think of this. Generosity is not a money issue. It is a heart issue. Look at what Paul said to the Corinthian church in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 1 to 5. This is the time when Paul was raising funds for the Jerusalem church. So he wrote to the Corinthian church, and says like this in chapter 8, 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 1 to 5. And now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. Started with the grace of God. Okay? In the midst of a very severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. That's something very deep for Paul said. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able, and even beyond their ability, entirely on their own. They urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in the service to those people. Paul called it a privilege. And they exceeded our expectations. They gave themselves first of all to the Lord, and then by the will of God also to us. Again, generosity is not for the rich, nor it starts with money. It starts with the right heart. The Macedonian churches were going through severe trial themselves. They should have said, Paul, why don't you collect raise funds for us because we are poor? But instead, the Macedonian church out of a severe trial. I do not know, maybe a hurricane went through there, or an earthquake, or a disaster, or maybe they're being persecuted. But they were under severe trial. This is a good time to ask for help because they're in severe trial. But instead, they asked to give more because they saw it as a privilege. And it says they were in extreme poverty. I don't know, maybe most of us have seen what is extreme poverty looks like. You know, they were what we call dirt poor, indigent. So the Macedonian churches had the right excuse
to give. But instead, they pleaded with Paul to be part of this privilege of giving and being generous. The current situation or the condition they were in did not stop them from giving generously. They gave beyond their ability. Think of that. The Macedonian churches gave beyond their ability, as much as they were able, entirely on their own. They were not forced. They pleaded with Paul to be part of it. They saw it as a privilege. They exceeded expectation. So, again, generosity does not happen because we have lots of money or lack of money. It starts from the heart. Just like Paul said, by the grace of God, they were touched by God Himself. The secret is first they gave themselves to the Lord. If you remember the story, there's a story in the Bible about a very rich man. And he was very selfish, self-centered. He didn't want to share his wealth to others. He was stingy. He was what we call poripo, selfish. His name was Zacchaeus. Remember that short man that went up to the tree to see Jesus? Everybody hated him because he cheated them with their taxes, and you know, he was a corrupt government official. But then when Jesus saw him one day and Jesus went to his house, he stood up and said, "Lord, I will give 50% of my wealth to the poor." How did that happen? Because that day, Jesus went to his house. That day, Jesus changed his heart. See, he was rich, but then he was selfish. He was not generous. Because again, the generous doesn't start with having a lot of money. It starts with the heart. It is never a money issue. It is a heart issue. To be generous, okay? Allow the Lord to touch your heart, just like how He touched the heart in the life of Zacchaeus. He said, "I will give 50% of my wealth." How much do you have? You willing to give 50%? That's hard, right? But again, when the Lord has touched you and has told you, you respond. Second point is that generosity is powerful. It can transform lives. It can change situations. Let me use the Eden Church as an example. So again, I said, I'd be mixing with reporting what had happened. And the message today, I'm just going to put it together. We talk about generosity. Again, generosity is powerful. It can transform lives. It can change situations. The Eden Church was not a church before. We were helping them do a street evangelism with the children. We would gather children, and man, Philippines, there's a lot of kids. like a factory of children. A lot of kids. But then they started with street evangelism. They would go to the neighborhood and they were not thinking of, or they didn't have a plan to start a church. They just reach out to the kids and then send them to churches. And we were part of that. We were giving them some help to buy food. Okay? But then in 2020, the pandemic hit. Churches were closed. Gatherings was banned. People lost their livelihood, nothing to eat, and they could no longer reach out to the children. But at the height of the pandemic, the church in Eden was birthed. How did that happen? It's because they changed the way they approached. Instead of giving lollipop to the kids, they gave grocery to the family, because at that time there was no food for the family because they lost their jobs. So at the height of the pandemic, I think that sometime in April, March, June, they were giving groceries away. And then they started a church. At the time when they were not allowed to gather. So it's a miracle. And it was because we sent them some help, financial help. And as a result, the church was birthed, and this church that we're talking about, the three churches that we're talking about, these are not old Christians. These are very new Christians. They just surrendered their lives to the Lord. They're not like they've been Christian for a long time that they came together and they became a church. So they were new Christians. They just gave themselves to the Lord. And as a matter of fact, the Bukidnon Church, people that they're reaching out are animists. They worship the trees. They worship the rivers. But because of generosity, because of your generosity, lives are being transformed. I mean, it's a miracle. On our last night there, we took the worship team. Most of them are in high school. And we took them out for dinner. And they shared about their lives. First of all, if you've watched some of the videos that we posted and the way they lead worship and the way they play instrument, all I can say is they're so good. They have been anointed by the Lord, because you know why? None of them had a formal training when it comes to musical instruments. They just learned it from the where? YouTube. We just learned it from YouTube. And their testimony was that they were invited to go to the church, and first they liked it. But then their families didn't want them to go to the church. Their parents, the grandparents told them not to go to church. But then these kids, they were touched by God, and they continued to go to church. Finally, most of them, their family, joined in church, and they're serving the Lord as a family. Generosity can do something and transform, which is powerful. It can change a current situation. It can transform lives. I'd like to show you what generosity can do with a picture. Read again. That is the Buchanan Church. That was the Buchanan Church. It's made of bamboo and tarp. I'll show you the next picture. Okay. That was the church. It's a bamboo. That's the highway out there. And he put the dirt floor. And they just put a bench for them to sit down. Next picture. So there they are. Actually, these are from Bumaran Church they visited. So that's the church. That was the church. Because of your generosity, the church already looked like this. Excellent. The floor. And he was so shy because they love pasta. And I saw some of them pick out their shoes before they go in. And the next one, that's how the church looks like now. Next. That's the front, and they just put the stairs. And the next one. So the church looks like that. These are the Bumaran people sing because they love to sing. So, is there another picture? Yeah. So now they have sound system. They have a pulpit. There's no drum yet, but they've just bought the electric guitar and the acoustic guitar, and they also have keyboard now. They just need somebody to play. But what I'm trying to tell you is that generosity can change and transform lives and can change situations. I mean, from that bamboo thing, the tarp, to that beautiful building. It's because of generosity. Right now they have a children's room and they're still in the mud. They just put something on the floor, a mat on the floor so that the kids will not have the muddy classroom, but they're still there. But generosity can change lives and transform lives and change situations. That's what generosity can do. I hope and pray that we'll continue to be generous. And of course, we are helping other churches around the world. We're helping India, we're helping Cambodia, and many places. But I've never been there yet, so I cannot really make a report to you on their situation. My last point this morning is generosity keeps the blessings flowing. Do you want to see most of our prayer always involving, Lord, bless me. Lord, bless them. We always think about blessings. And one of the things that we can do to keep the blessings of the Lord flowing through our lives is through generosity. I'd like to read to you the parable that Jesus gave, or Jesus told in Matthew chapter 25, 14 to 30. Just bear with me, it's a little long to read, but you have to read it to understand what it means. Verse 14, this is Jesus saying, again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. To one, he gave 5 bags of gold, to another, 2 bags, and to another, 1 bag. Each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 bags more. So also the one who had 2 bags of gold gained 2 more. But the man who had received 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with few things. I will put you in charge of many things. You underline that part. Okay. You have been faithful with small things. I will trust you with so many, many things. The man with 2 bags of gold also came. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 2 bags of gold. See, I have gained 2 more. Come and share your master's happiness. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Then the man who had received 1 bag of gold, the master said, I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here it is, what belongs to you. So you return without using it. He just hid it. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with a banker so that when I return, I would have received it back with interest. So take the bag of gold from him and give it to the one who has 10 bags. For whoever has been given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have even what they have will be taken from them. And to the worthless servant outside in the darkness, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. The biggest lesson I learned from this parable is this. First of all, everything that we have doesn't belong to us. Everything that you have, your money, whatever gold that you have, doesn't belong to you. They belong to God. We are just stewards. We are just managers. The air that we breathe. I mean, look around you. Did we come into this world with something? No, we didn't. We belong to the Lord. So the very first thing that we can learn from this parable is that everything that we have doesn't belong to us. We are just stewards and managers. God expects us to be good managers and good stewards. The second lesson that I learned from this parable is that if we mismanage what God has entrusted to us, He will not hesitate to take it back. He will not hesitate to take it back. And the third lesson that we can pick up from this parable is that when we manage well what God has entrusted to us, He will reward us and will put us in charge of men. In other words, He'll put more blessings into our hands. This is how God set up things. If you remember, when God called Abraham, He told Abraham, "I will bless you." Did God bless Abraham? What do you think? When God said, "I will bless you," was there any evidence that God blessed Abraham? Yes, he becomes so wealthy. But here's the next thing that Jesus, that God told Abraham, "I will bless you, and that so that others will be blessed through you." So that is how God set up His blessings. He will bless us so that we can bless others. Abraham became so wealthy, but through him, others will be blessed. Again, let's look at some scriptures that we have read earlier, and let's go back to Hebrews chapter 6, verse 10. God is not unjust, Hebrews 6, verse 10. He will not forget your work and the love you have shown Him as you have helped. So generosity, when we give, when we manage our resources well, the Bible tells us that God will not forget your work and the love you have for people. God is not going to forget it. That's why the blessings keep flowing. Proverbs 2:19-17. Whoever is kind to the poor lends to the Lord, and He will reward them. So there is a reward. He will reward them for what they have done. And last one, Hebrews 13:16. Do not forget to do good and to share with others, for with such sacrifices God is pleased. See, to be generous and to manage well what the Lord has put in our hands, God is going to reward, just like the parable. The parable is that when the two servants who have managed well and generous, they receive more reward from the master. They were given more opportunity to manage more blessing. So don't forget, when it comes to generosity, it starts with the heart. It's never a money issue. It is a heart issue. Secondly, your generosity will touch many lives. It can change situations. It can transform lives. It can even touch people's lives so that they will have an eternal life by giving themselves to the Lord. Surrendering themselves to the Lord. And thirdly, when we are generous, God is watching. If you want more blessings from the Lord, manage your wealth and your resources well. He will not forget what you have done. Do good to others. So how are we maturing in our generosity? One thing I can say is that we as a church, we are generous. Never let the enemy take it away from you. Just continue to give to the Lord, to give to the Lord. First, and to be generous to others. I can't imagine, there's a song, and it's an old song that talks about when he walked into the heavens, there were people waiting there and saying, thank you for giving to the Lord. Remember that song? Because of your generosity, I am here. Thank you. Generosity is not something that is a waste of your wealth. It is something that can touch lives. It is something that can change lives. It is a way of hearing more blessings from the Lord and receiving more blessings from the Lord. Because if we are stingy, the Lord will not put more blessings into our hands. Because again, we are just vessels, we are just instruments. The Lord uses to bless others through you. So do not be weary in being generous. Continue to be generous in the eyes of the Lord. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for allowing us to enjoy the many blessings that comes from you. But you require us to manage it well. You require us to be generous to others. Because generosity can transform lives. Generosity can change situations. Lord, we have seen it. We have experienced it firsthand. How generosity can change situations. Because of generosity, we are able to reach out to many people that have heard the gospel. Many people are giving their lives and surrendering their lives to the Lord. People that used to worship the trees, the rivers, and the spirits, now they are showing up in the church. Surrendering their lives to the Lord. Lord, as we have been blessed tremendously in this country, we have been blessed tremendously every day. Help us be generous always. Help us to have the right heart, because generosity starts with a heart surrendered to the Lord. Never about money, it's a heart issue, never about money issue. Like the Macedonian churches, Lord, we want to have the privilege of giving and helping those who are in me. I ask you, Lord, that as we are generous, our blessings will come our way so that we can bless more those who are in me. To help the continue to give us a heart that is generous. Lord, we thank you for this Thanksgiving season. Lord, I pray that you will change the way we celebrate Thanksgiving. We will celebrate, give thanks by giving. And it's our prayer today. Thank you. We praise you. Jesus' name. Let us all.